you, Roger. So my name's Sarah Ahern and I currently work with Public Health at Bradford Council, but I also work within the Born in Bradford programme. So I'm hoping by now it's become a little bit clearer why we're talking about school travel in a session called The Environment. But if not, I'm going to spend the first couple of minutes providing some context as to why this study is relevant to the session and why it's relevant to our city. So, air pollution in Bradford. Bradford in the 19th century was a major industrial hub in the UK, and as a result was a smoggy, smoky, polluted city. And if we fast forward to the present day, what we see is a much cleaner picture. But you might be surprised to find out, you might not if you've looked at today's TNA, that it's not actually all that clean a picture. And West Yorkshire, including Bradford, has some of the worst air quality in the country. And by far the biggest contributor to that is road traffic. So why does this matter? Well, we've already heard an excellent talk this morning that mentioned air pollution and the health impacts, and there are many. But one of the other issues is that it seems to be our most deprived communities who experience the highest concentrations of air pollution. And because of the health impacts, this means that it's likely that our air quality issues are contributing to already existing health inequalities in Bradford. This makes it vital that we're looking at ways of reducing people's exposure in these areas, but also that we're reducing traffic emissions, and both of these things that mean that we need to change people's behaviour. So one of the suggested strategies is to promote active travel. And by active travel, we mean any form of travel that requires some level of physical activity from the individual and doesn't rely on motorised transport. So it most commonly refers to cycling and walking, but it can be things like scooting and skating as well. So the more people we encourage to swap their car for active travel, particularly for short journeys, fewer cars on the road, the less air pollution, the better our air quality. And we also have the added benefit of increasing people's physical activity levels. And there's a whole session this afternoon where some of my colleagues will be explaining why that's also incredibly important. So coming back to the title of the session, why are we focusing on school travel? Well, we know that the school journey significantly impacts on peak travel. And we know that at least one in five cars on the road at peak travel time is actually on its way to school. We also know that primary school children are far more likely to be driven to school than secondary. And in fact, less than half of primary school children are currently walking to school. Pretty much the exact same number are being driven, so that shows you how few are taking public transport or using any other form of transport. But it's this 46% that we're particularly interested in. Are there things that we can be doing to help the parents of these children to get them out of the car and walking to school? So before we think of ways that we can change behaviour, we need to understand that behaviour in context. We need to know why parents are already making the decisions around school travel that they are. So over the years, behaviour theorists have developed a number of different models that they think explain why we do the things that we do. And we've used a framework that's brought all these things together to give a comprehensive list of behavioural determinants or factors that influence why we behave the way that we do. And this framework also accounts for the fact that behaviour affects and is affected by multiple levels of influence. So at the most basic level, we're influenced by internal factors, things that we know, things that we feel, the skills that we have, but also external factors, so what other people think and feel, and also our environmental context and resources, so things like how much time we have, the cost involved, and what infrastructure is in place. So to understand parents' decisions, we decided to talk to parents. We developed interview questions using the framework that I've just described. We recruited parents from primary schools across West Yorkshire, and those were parents whose children currently walked or were driven or took public transport. And we interviewed 20 of them. The interviews were recorded using a digital recorder. We transcribed them, and then we used the framework to code those transcriptions, so to look for patterns in what parents were telling us and try and identify some of the barriers and enablers to walking to school. So what were parents telling us? I think the first interesting thing for me was that although parents reported that children were generally always taking to school in one way, it actually seemed from the interviews that it was pretty rare that children were always taking to school in one way. So there seems to be some level of flexibility there already. Most parents understood the benefits of walking to school. They wanted their children to be able to walk to school, and they saw it as important for their health and independence. So attitudes were predominantly positive. One of the other nice benefits that a couple of parents mentioned of walking to school, which I thought were really nice, was the social aspect of it. So here we've got a mum saying, if we walk together, it's a nice time. It's nice that you can catch up, like walking home from school, you can catch up on your day. So she sees this time of walking home from school as additional quality time with her child. But some parents also talked to us about concerns about safety, and these are most commonly related to road safety. But this only seemed to be a barrier to independent mobility, so whether children were walking to school on their own, and didn't seem to stop parents from walking their children to school. One of the other important issues was the fact that parents didn't actually seem to feel like they had a choice in how they took their parents to school, took their children to school. They felt that their decision was dictated by their circumstances. So that's really important when we're thinking about how we might tackle this issue. In terms of parents' relationships, there were some parents who were influenced by their children's attitude towards walking, and mostly this was positive. So if a lot of children wanted to walk, parents would want them to walk. But it did work the other way as well, and here we've got a quote from a mum who was saying that they generally get the bus because her little boy doesn't like to walk to school. For those parents whose children were walking, for a lot of them this was because there was some level of social support there. So it could be there's an elder sibling, a grandparent, or in this case a childminder who's actually taking responsibility for getting the child to school. And that's really important to think about because a lot of parents won't have access to that additional childcare. And then finally, having other young children, particularly of toddler age, could be a barrier for some parents. So negotiating a toddler on the walk to school could make it very difficult. So either they'll decide to start thinking about sending that child, that school-aged child, on their own, or they'll decide to take the car because it's easier. A lot of parents talked to us about the efforts schools were already making to reduce some of the barriers. So here we've got a dad who was talking about the school trying to tackle on-curb parking, which some of the parents felt was a safety issue, and also a school that put together a walking bus to try and encourage walking. What we did find out from parents is that generally schools aren't having much success with these types of interventions. So this might point to the fact that they need some external help in ensuring that they are successful, and in the case of the walking bus, there were issues around sustainability. Other people's parking came up from pretty much every parent that I spoke to, and this was a really interesting one because it seemed to act as a barrier for walking for some people, so it was a safety issue, or it was a barrier to driving because parents couldn't bear to go anywhere near the school in their car. So it just shows you how complex parents' decisions are around school travel. By far the biggest influences on parents' decisions were their environmental context, so distance. Pretty much all of the parents who were driving felt they lived too far away from the school to walk. And for some of those parents, that difficulty was exacerbated by the fact that they didn't get their children into local schools. So this points to the fact that we might actually need to look at school travel in more detail in things like school admissions policies and new school developments. Along with distance were time constraints, so many of the parents who drove also worked, and they had to get their children to school on that commute to work, which might actually suggest that some of these 46% of parents, they're working parents, and that's where we should be tailoring this intervention. And this idea of incorporating multiple trips came up again and again, so as well as the work commute, there was getting children to after-school activities. So these are things for us to bear in mind. So your takeaway messages, hopefully I've come in under time, from the talk, are that there seems to be some level of flexibility with school travel, and this might be something that we can use as a foundation to build on when we're thinking about how we can help parents. Parents are generally very, very positive, so the motivation is already there, so that's also something we can build on. Schools may benefit from additional support in ensuring the effectiveness and sustainability of interventions, and these interventions might be particularly successful if they're tailored to working parents. But one of the other issues that we think is really important is this idea of addressing school travel within the school admissions policies and new school developments, because we might see a much larger shift in behaviour this way. So just to thank my colleagues at the 5 West Yorkshire Councils who helped me with recruitment of the schools and parents.